Too much to say.
Everybody, wash your hands. Cover your mouth when you cough. If you are sick, stay home.
Die quickly.
And now?
John and Ken Show. John Cobell and Ken Champeau. KFI AM 640.
Today, apparently President Trump tweeted out that the media is not my enemy. The media is the enemy of the American people. See, he knows. He wants to stand strong with us. It's going to be all the people against the media. And we told you last week, there's a poll that came out that people actually trust Trump more than the media. So, you know, it's not like he's making stuff up. I found a pretty good editorial in the Washington Times. Two of the media outlets that Trump has attacked are the Washington Post and the New York Times, although today he also singled out, of course, CNN for a blistering attack, and then the three major networks, NBC, ABC, and CBS. Washington Post editor Marty Baron said this week that his paper is treating the Trump administration the exact way it would a Clinton administration. And we are not the opposition party. He was actually at the Ritz-Carlton in Dana Point, the Ritz-Carlton, for a code media conference. They were here a couple of days ago, yes. The way I view it, we're not at war with the administration. We're at work. We're doing our jobs.
Yeah.
He said the Clinton administration would be treated the exact same way. And as far as being the opposition, we're not the opposition either. We're independent. And I think we've reached a strange point. We're just being independent, which the press should be, is portrayed as being opposition.
It's not, because they're covering him completely different than Hillary.
Yes.
Completely different than Obama. In fact, there are multiple sites. If we wanted to take an hour, I could read you all the news stories that the Washington Post and the rest of their ilk has put out. And it's turned out to be wildly exaggerated, flat-out wrong, or just out of proportion, out of context, and certainly way more intense than they cover exactly the same story under other presidents. For example, we just told you a few minutes ago how about Trump had 683 criminal aliens arrested this week, and all hell broke loose in the media.
Obama would do that.
I sent out a tweet yesterday saying, hey, on a certain day in 2012, we issued this press release. It was 3,168 criminal aliens rounded up by the Obama administration. Five times as many, got hardly any notice in the media.
Well,
because it was Obama doing it, and nobody outside the crazy activists, nobody in the media was accusing Obama of sending fear through the immigrant communities and tearing families apart. They simply didn't do that. They did it for the Trump roundups.
Now, the writer here in the Washington Times, Kelly Riddell, writes in the next paragraph, funny, in November, the former CEO of NPR wrote in a Vanity Fair article that some days he feels as though the Washington Post has become the Breitbart for the left. Wednesday's coverage in the Post exemplified his point. On the Post's online front page, all featured six stories involving President Trump. All were negative. Admittedly, the firing of Trump's national security advisor, Michael Flynn, did send shockwaves throughout Washington. But there were other stories. The same day, Trump had a pretty good meeting with the Israeli Prime Minister, Benjamin Netanyahu. And Secretary of Defense James Mattis was meeting with NATO allies in Europe. The U.S. stock market is soaring. On Thursday, the coverage not better. Of the four feature articles, all of them focused on Trump. One with the snarky headline, campaigning like it's 2016. Trump is stuck in a time warp. It's hard to imagine Hillary Clinton would have been treated the same way. Even though she too had low favorability numbers and was thought dishonest by the majority of Americans. The New York Times also feels its coverage of the administration is fair. Earlier this month, the Times CEO Mark Thompson stopped by CNBC's Power Lunch and explained that his paper played it straight. We aim to be objective and to tell people straightforwardly what's happening. Yet its own public editor, somebody named Liz Spade, admitted the Times got so wrapped up covering Trump's daily controversies during the campaign, it missed the real story on why he resonated with voters. She said, as the Times began a period of self-reflection, I hope its editors will think hard about the half of America the paper too seldom covers.
I was just reading a column by one of the Washington writers, and he said a journalist friend of his sent him a text and that there's a bunch of guys watching Trump's press conference at the gym and everybody is laughing and enjoying it. They loved Trump insulting and giving a hard time to all the news media guys. that the gym was in an uproar. Everybody was laughing, rooting Trump on against the media. So while the media people tore their garments apart and wrote these long stories about how they're suffering all this abuse from Trump, the common people over at the gym were laughing their asses off like it was a comedy roast. There's a huge disconnect between the people and the media.
Yeah, and that's what Trump is playing to. I mean, he did that well during the campaign.
Yeah.
He found those people, and they earned him a margin of victory. And he still believes they're going to stand behind him because, you know.
They blew their credibility, so this is what's left. And they're not going to get it back anytime soon. So they're going to keep going after Trump, and half the country, at least, is going to keep laughing at the media and mocking the media and not believing the
media.
Now,
that being said,
and Trump is going to keep playing to that crowd.
That being said, this could be good business for both sides. It could be that, you know, the media is like, well, I should be fair and impartial. Probably won't get us as many avid followers if we are. We might as well go full bore against Trump. There's a good audience for that. It's like half the country.
Yeah, exactly. So that's what they're going to do. But everyone now knows it up front. CNN is going to run anti-Trump programming. They're a bunch of leftists, and they want to delegitimize Trump, and they want to give that programming to all the coastal elites who are so angry and upset, and they're running around in their homes wearing their pink hats, and they want to see Trump attacked and insulted. Guys like Don Lemon.
Yeah.
That's what they're going to do. That's not news, though. That's not objective news reporting. It's entertainment. It's showbiz. Welcome to the club. All right? Now you're part of the entertainment business. Same thing with the newspapers. They've joined the entertainment business, whipping up the emotions of the partisan readership that they've cultivated over the years. L.A. Times, yeah, is Breitbart of the left. So is the Washington Post. All right? We got the demarcation now. Got the line drawn. Breitbart pro-Trump, L.A. Times anti-Trump. Neither's going to give you an objective straight story on what the news is. Good luck if that's what you're into.
Yeah, that's what you face today.
But apparently there's not that many people into it anymore.
You know, if they're complaining that the country has got such a partisan divide that, they've added to it because they took a side. They're going to be the anti-Trump media. Why not?
That's right, because in this business climate, when you have so much competition, such a fragmented media landscape, right? I mean, honestly, it's just on my radio, right? With satellite radio, I got like 250 channels I can choose from. You go on the web, you have millions of places that you can go, right? Television, I got another like 500 channels. I don't know, my TV goes up to channel 1900. It's crazy. So you're CNN, and you're capable of, you know, spawning billions of dollars in revenue if you play it right. You have to pick a side. You have to pick a niche. You have to pick a hot-button niche that gets the adrenaline pumping. And the pink hat crowd, their adrenaline is pumping every time Trump is made to look like a fool. So that's what they're playing to.
A recent New York Times Sunday edition, there wasn't one positive Trump story to be found, but a reader could get the scoop on why federal civil servants felt a sense of dread and how Republicans in Washington are flummoxed by the complexities of one-party rule. And then, of course, their hard-hitting piece on how Trump's team is so inept they can't even operate the lights in the White House. I mean, that's just silly stuff.
It is. It is. But there you go. It's the death of journalism. Death of truth, death of facts, death
independent of journalism. They'll still be what they call journalism, but they'll just be writing the stories, you know, to please their audience. That's because, you know what? Websites are full of ads. That's the only way they make money. Newspapers have ads. The websites have ads. They have to get you to click.
And the advertisers just want an audience, and they don't care how the audience got there or why. They just want the audience. So if you can run a left-wing news network beating the crap out of Trump every day with false, exaggerated stories, hey, does that bring an audience? There you go. I can run my ad on your show.